Hey brothers and sisters, this is Brother Patrick here in the Philippines. I wanted to make a video. You know, the Lord is showing me stuff as I study the Word and pray all the time, but 90% of it I don't write down, and I don't make a video about, or a large part of it. And I just felt led by the Lord just to go ahead and just start sharing these things, because the Lord would give me some information and then I don't always put it together. But I want to go through some things that the Lord has been showing me. Here's, let me start with this one, and I might title this video, you know, Better of Understanding of the Book of Revelation. And, you know, the Bible says it's, you know, it's, I always misquote this Bible verse, but it basically says, you know, the delight of the Lord is, you know, to conceal a matter, and the joy of a king to find it, or something like that, anyway. So the Lord is, you know, the Bible is a mystery, particularly the book of Revelation. Now, not mystery about salvation. Now, the New Testament reveals the mystery of that Jesus is the Christ, that we're saved through Christ. We know all that. If you're a Christian, we know that the mystery of God is revealed. But we're talking about, I'm talking about the end times and all those kind of things. And the mysteries of the universe. You know, the way of creation and all this kind of stuff that we would learn when we get to heaven. But all those details about the ways of creation and all this is really not so important for us to know in this time. But the subject matter that is at hand is the end times. Now, once you're born again and you're saved, and then you can start talking about being, you know, we have one baptism and all that stuff. It tells us in Hebrews, I believe, chapter 6. So we have one Lord, one baptism. And then you talk about being baptized in the Holy Spirit, which, and throughout the book of Acts, we see that is manifested with the manifestation of speaking in tongues as the result of being baptized in the Holy Spirit, initial baptism in the Holy Spirit. Then beyond that, the task that's at hand and the future that is immediately before us is the tribulation period. So that is really the focus of my videos. And the Lord gave me the name of the church, excuse me, that I have, which is that I started online, Church of the Firstborn. And the link is down here below. If you have a prayer request, you want to be involved in the prayer teams, if you want to be involved in ministering to people, you know, I'm still looking for a sister to handle, I think we already have a women, anyway, like a, you know, abortion recovery and all this kind of different stuff that we need to add more ministries. If you feel led by the Lord to do a ministry, you know, go to the website and send a message to Brother Sid. The link is on there, and offer yourself as a living sacrifice to be used by the Lord for the church. This is the biggest part for me for the church, is to allow other people to grow into their calling in the Lord and do the Lord's will. Your leadership development. And then beyond that, of course, we're ministering to people. But I'm trying to minister to those who minister to people. That's my personal part of the Church of the Firstborn. But the mission that the Lord gave for the Church of the Firstborn is, that text is from up there in Hebrews chapter 13, when it talks about getting up there in the rapture, really. Talking about being in the presence of the Father and the holy angels and the saints who have already gone on and coming to Mount Zion. We're not there with Moses, where he feared and trembled so much that even Moses was afraid. And the people were afraid to go up to the mountain. But we come to Mount Zion, you know, to the church of the firstborn. And it talks about even where the Father is, the angels and the saints that are already there. So the mission of the Church of the Firstborn, and the reason why the Lord gave the name, is because that text is really referring to when all things are reconciled in Christ. The Bible says God will reconcile all things in Christ at the end. And that's what we're talking about. That's the focus and the end goal. That's the prize. The Bible says to run the race. What race? The race of overcoming this world, of the high calling that we have in Christ, overcoming the world, the flesh, and the devil. When Jesus wrote to the churches in Revelation, the Lord's got me preaching, but I want to talk about Revelation, some teaching. Well, what can you do? Well, it's by the Spirit of God, right? When the Lord was writing to those churches, what did he say? To he who overcomes. Let me say this about denominations. And I thank God Almighty, because God really called me, like in a spirit of Elijah, spirit of John the Baptist and all that, to be an outsider. Thank the Lord for that. You know, and by his grace, I'm not perfect, but I'm not, by his grace, not corrupted in religious things. You know what I'm saying? Simony and all that kind of stuff. Go look that up. Acts chapter 8. They call it simony. Anyway, brothers and sisters, look at those letters that the Lord wrote to those churches. Here's something you can tell about those letters. In Revelation chapter 2 and chapter 3, there's seven letters to seven churches in Asia Minor, which apply to us today. Not only is it the church ages, not only is it real churches in those days, there's multiple layers and meanings. It's also something we can glean out of each one. Everything in there is for us. Okay. Number one, it shows you that the natural tendencies of churches is to start out on fire with their first love and then to fall away. So I've always noticed this. And now, the Lord has illuminated and lit my mind from the Word of God from Revelation 2 and 3 as I've been looking at it tonight. And lots of things the Lord showed me. Thank God I've been asking for revelation and illumination, and the Lord is revealing to me. Here's the deal. My thesis and my hypothesis in the past has been that the older a denomination, the more corruption is in there. And it's true. The older the denomination, the more time they've had for the tares to come in and take over. I mean, that's exactly what's happened. And I always use the example of the Methodists as the greatest example. Even though, you talk about the Roman Catholics and all that. Okay, that's like the oldest denomination that's still around today. But let's talk about, and the exception is churches that are persecuted. Unfortunately, and sad to say, when churches are persecuted, then when it's all boils down, they're ready, they're not willing to die for their traditions. They're not willing to die for a Christmas tree or Easter eggs or die for, fighting over Saturday versus Sunday and all this kind of stuff. But they're willing to die not to deny the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. And they've been blood-bought, spirit-filled saints of God, and they're willing to die to be counted in the name of Jesus Christ rather than deny the Lord that bought them. So all these other things fade away. That's why you see the Waldensians and all these guys, their doctrine remain pure because people, when it comes down to it, are only willing to have the grace to die. And persecution like that, except for the truth, is what they believe, absolute bottom truth from the Lord. Cults aside. Anyway, brothers and sisters, so another thing that we can glean from those churches in Revelation 2 and chapter 3 of the book of Revelation is it says, he who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith to the church. So those who are overcomers, they can read the Word of God, and they read the Word of God diligently, because that's where the main part where the Lord has spoken is through his Word. Now, he illuminates and highlights parts of his word from the word. We call that a rhema word. The word is the logos of God. Jesus is the word of God, the logos. The Bible is the logos, the word of God. It's a Greek word for the word. But a rhema is a quickened, and quickened means given life to, a quickened word from the word. God will illuminate part of the word to you. That is a rhema word. Now, the Lord uses his word primarily as a source to speak to people. So that's why whenever someone says the Lord spoke to them, it always, always, always has to be backed up by two or more witnesses from the Scripture of God. We must confirm it by the Word of God. Now that's why, look, brothers and sisters, I got to make a separate video on this stuff about the blood moons and all that. It's just like, this is a problem in science. I think I mentioned this in the book that the Lord gave me to write. I think I talked about this. I can't remember. I've made videos about it. It's like this. When you talk about like evolution and all that, okay, this is how they build it. And religion is the same way. They build scaffolding. You know what scaffolding they build? They start out on a rock. This is a fact. We can see that, here's a rock. In geology, we see a rock laying on the ground. And we know that's a rock, just like Jesus is a rock. Then they start building scaffolding off of that, like in geology. They will tell you that when they dig down through the earth, when they get down to this point, it's 10 million years. And when they get down to this point, it's 100 million years and all that. Okay, but yet, they have a term, I think they call it, out of place. In archaeology and geology and all that, geology is study of the earth, like geometry. There's another whole other topic. How geometry and the study of the earth, as I was just saying, geology. Anyway, they have what they call these anomalies, like where they find dinosaur footprints, where there's human footprints together in the same strata, like in the Creation Museum. There's several different ones. There's one in Glen Rose, Texas, probably the best one that I know about. And by the grace of God, I'm going to visit there when I'm in Dallas next time. It's just maybe 30 minutes or an hour from Dallas. And then you have these anomalies. They find human bones, and they found like a rock with a head of a human-made head of a hammer or mallet inside the rock, things like that, that are anomalies. So what they do in science, they reject those things. They reject those things because it goes outside their their paradigm that there is no God. So they build scaffolding. So one geologist digs and he finds some rocks under there, and he'll say it's supposed to be from the Ice Age. He'll say, okay, this is at the strata that's 10 million years ago. Okay. So he makes that statement just based on his opinion or what and whatnot. Then some other guy comes along and digs, and he digs down there. He finds something at the level, and he says, well, according to, you know, Dr. A, this is 10 million years strata here. So I found this at this same level. So this endorses and confirms what Dr. A said. So now Dr. B confirms it by finding something that jibes with their paradigm, their box of evolution, and there is no God, and the Ice Ages and all that, and the old Earth, whatever they want to say. Okay, just on that topic, as the Lord has got me on this, Adam was not created as a newborn baby. Adam was created with age. Adam was created as a grown man. So why in the world wouldn't God create the Earth as with age? Not an evolving Earth, but boom, there it is, complete, ready to go. Just like he did man. Like the old adage, which came first, the chicken or the egg? You know, it sounds simple. You've probably heard it your whole life, but think about it. How could an egg be there with nobody sitting on it? How could an egg come to maturity and hatch if there wasn't a mature chicken to sit on it? And how could the egg been laid if there wasn't a mature chicken to lay it? And how did they do that without a mate? So the old adage is that only creation can answer is which came first, the chicken or the egg. Of course, there had to be an adult chicken created by God, or there could have never been any eggs. This is just so simple, but yet it confounds the wise brothers and sisters. So in science, they build this scaffolding on and on and on, and they reference back. Some Dr. C references back to Dr. A, and then Dr. A will reference Dr. B, and then he'll reference Dr. D, and they just all interact, and the whole thing is built on smoke and mirrors, and some archaeologist or geologist trying to get a grant and government funding to go do a dig and get in the news and publish a paper and become famous. It's all built on smoke and mirrors and lies, and not built on the rock. The same thing is true with religion, brothers and sisters. I've mentioned this before. I used to listen to on the radio when I first became a pastor. Excuse me, there's only one Christian station that has a good signal there in Winston-Salem, where I came from, 8:30 a.m. WTRU. Now they're nationwide. It's a father and son that own it. This guy's Stu Epperson Jr. They've got a nationwide networks radio show. Okay, now they're Presbyterians, and they're amillennialists, and they're predestination people, and they're, you know, they have all this, they don't have a literal interpretation of the Bible. So anyway, they had people like Dr. G. James Kennedy on there, who is now deceased, and he's got a good voice, and he had a big church there, Coral Gables, Florida, and he's a nice guy, and he was a born-again Christian. Don't get me wrong. But now, when I listened to Dr. D. James Kennedy preach, when I was a brand new, everything he quoted was from St. Augustine and R.C. Sproul, who I admire. You know, I admire smart people. R.C. Sproul is another Calvinist, like Dr. D. James Kennedy, who's very smart man. He has lots of great teachings, don't get me wrong. But everything they quote is never from the Word of God. It's always from St. Augustine and all this other stuff. It's built on scaffolding of someone's opinion based off, and they made their opinion not based off the Bible. They based their opinion off of the opinion of Augustine, and then so-and-so based theirs off of, you know, of so-and-so, and then it's just all interwoven people's opinion, and then they ran with that opinion as if it was fact, because the guy said it 500 years ago, it must be holy because it was said 500 years ago, and they ran with it and ran with it and ran with it and ran with it, and you end up with something that doesn't look nothing like the gospel. That's why Jesus said return to your first love. We can't be loving the saints that's going on, you know, this saint worship and all that, and idolizing, St. Augustine, or idolizing, you know, some famous preacher 200 years ago, or even Billy Graham or whomever. We need to go back to our first love. That's the Lord Jesus Christ. That is our first love, brothers and sisters. That is what our high calling is to run the race that the Lord has set before us and go for the prize. You know, not everyone that runs wins, Paul said. So he was referring to really to the Olympics as a metaphor or an analogy, whatever you want to call it, of finishing the race, going on into the kingdom of God. as we are surrounded by such a great crowd, crowd of witnesses, that they're looking on and cheering us on, brothers and sisters, to the finish line. Now we're running down, running to the finish line, and that's what I'll make a second video about that. Get yourself right. Think about this. The day is coming. As I mentioned, the Lord would reconcile all things in himself. And I didn't have time to look it up, but the Lord had reminded me. Even all of the people that worship the devil and Allah and all that stuff, the Bible says God will turn it all to reconcile, to bring glory to the Lord Jesus Christ. Everything, every sacrifice that's ever been made to an idol and all that stuff, it'll be turned, brothers and sisters. All things will be reconciled and give glory to God. All those things that people have done will be given glory to the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, what they did, but not them. When God brings his justice at the great white throne judgment, that's for non-believers, it will bring glory to God. The tribulation period, brothers and sisters, brings glory to God. The wrath of God ultimately brings glory to his name because he is a just and faithful God. And that's what he calls us to be. It says when the Lord returns to the earth, he will have his people with him. And they are called faithful. We are faithful and true to the Lord, and he is faithful and true to us. He is our Lord and our Christ. Just think about it. That day's coming when there'll be no more wars. As we stand on the precipice, really, of the war of Gog and Magog, World War III, and all this other stuff is going down, just at the door, remember that the day is coming. I'm not even talking about the rapture. I'm talking about the day is coming when the Lord returns to earth, and he will reconcile all things to himself. There will be no more wars. The lion will lay down with the lamb, you know, and the little child shall lead them, and you know, a snake and all this stuff and all the things that the promises there. I believe it's Isaiah chapter 17. The promises of God of the millennial kingdom of peace and grace and truth and justice. Can you imagine that? All the imaginations of man of a utopia and all these vain imaginations of making a utopia like communism and, you know, from the Illuminati trained what's his name that started communism? Who wrote the book? Marx, Karl Marx, Illuminati, a disciple of a famous Illuminati, illumined one. Brothers and sisters, the real utopia, the real peace of Jerusalem will come only when the Prince of Peace comes back. Praise God Almighty that the Lord himself, after he has his church with him, his bride with him, after the 7-year tribulation, he will return to this earth. We will be with him. Riding on white horses, the Bible tells us. He will return with 10,000s of his saints. Praise be God for that day that we will return with him and we will rule and reign on earth with him. Blessed be the name of the Lord. I want to cut this off because I got another video to make about the four blood moons and some things the Lord's been showing me. And I'm going to give it to you guys to pray over. And I know there's many of you guys who are good detectives and researchers. And let's see what we can come with. I got some good stuff.